जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी
वासुदेवाय
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामीनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे
Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So welcome to the Sunday feast, ISKCON Helsinki. So this is the auspicious time of the appearance of Lord Caitanya. So who is Lord Caitanya and why he appears? What is the need for appearance of the Lord so many times again and again? From all the scriptures, not just the Vedic scriptures, from all the religious scriptures of the world, we see that some form or the other of Lord is described and worshipped. He's worshipped as omniscient, omnipresent, most merciful. Why does he have to appear again and again? Why does he do such things? Is there some problem with his mercy or some problem with his power or what? So philosophers, scholars, they all speculate on such things and come up to many conclusions, and some eventually conclude that there is no God. Some conclude that there is God, but they themselves are the God. So it just requires a little bit of hard work and they'll become God. So all these kinds of philosophical speculations, some kind of, you know, mental exercises go on across the world. But if we have to understand who is God, we have to understand many other fundamental principles before that. Very commonsensical. So we accept the first principle of trying to understand God is acceptance. Acceptance that we are ignorant, we don't have any knowledge, and that we need to get it from some source, hopefully bona fide. So we are reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto, 9th chapter and 38th verse. So here, Prahlad Maharaj, who was a pure devotee of the Lord, is describing the reason why Lord is appearing. So in this verse, we'll just read this verse quickly. Ittham nratiryag rishi deva jhashavatarair lokan vibhavayasi hansi jagat pratipan dharmam mahapurusha pasi yugavanur vrittam channa kalau yad abhavastri yugotha svatvam. In this way, my Lord, you appear in various incarnations as a human being, an animal, a great saint, a demigod, a fish, or a tortoise, thus maintaining the entire creation in different planetary systems and killing the demonic principles. According to the age, O my Lord, you protect the principles of religion. In the age of Kali, however, you do not assert yourself as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and therefore you are known as Triyuga, or the Lord who appears in three yugas. Purport. As the Lord appeared just to maintain Lord Brahma from the attack of Madhu and Kaitabha, he also appeared to protect the great devotee Prahlad Maharaj. Similarly, Lord Chaitanya appeared in order to protect the fallen souls of Kali Yuga. There are four yugas or millenniums: Satya, Treta, Dwapar and Kali. In all the yugas but Kali Yuga, the Lord appears in various incarnations and asserts himself as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But although Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who appears in Kali Yuga, is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he never asserts himself as such. On the contrary, whenever Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was addressed as being as good as Krishna, he blocked his ears with his hands, denying his identity with Krishna because he was playing the part of a devotee. Lord Chaitanya knew that in Kali Yuga there would be many bogus incarnations pretending to be God, and therefore he avoided asserting himself as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is accepted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, however, in many Vedic literatures, especially in Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna Varnam Tusha Krishnam Sangopangastra Parshadam Yagyai Sankirtana Prayer Yajanti Hi Sumedasha. In Kali Yuga, the intelligent men worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead in the form of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is always accompanied by his associates such as Nityananda, Advaita, Gadadhar and Srivas. The entire Krishna consciousness movement is based on the principles of the Sankirtan movement inaugurated by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, one who tries to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead through the medium of Sankirtan movement knows everything perfectly. He is Sumedhas, a person with substantial intelligence. So, this verse, Prahlad Maharaj is praying to the Lord and he is explaining that the Lord appears in various forms and incarnations in every age or in every period of time. However, it's only in the age of Kali that he does not proclaim himself as the Lord. So this word specifically used here is Channa Kalau, hidden in the age of Kali. So Srila Prabhupada explains that actually the Supreme Lord appears at all times in all the species of life. So many scientific minded people believe in the process of evolution. The process of evolution according to the scriptures is a spiritual evolution. Evolution from the microbial species to aquatic, from aquatic to amphibious, from amphibious to reptilian, from reptilian to mammalian, and eventually to the form of human being. This evolution is a reality. But this is a reality based on the evolution of consciousness of the living entity, but it is not a physical evolution. The body does not change. A microbe does not become a fish. Fish does not become a frog. Frog doesn't become a snake. It's the consciousness which evolves, and the living entity gives up that body and takes another one. From our perspective, all these species of life are practically unconscious. But the Lord is so merciful that he appears in each of these species to deliver the living entities. So why does the Lord appear? Actually, what is the purpose of appearance of the Lord? Why does he have to appear? He is the Supreme Lord. He could do everything just by wishing. But why does he still appear specifically? For two reasons. First reason is, every living entity wants to be happy. And the second reason, which is our main problem, every living entity has his own free will. The Lord is all merciful. If he wishes, he can deliver the entire universes without even moving an eyelid. But he cannot do that because the living entity has a free will. The living entity is not going to be happy. The living entity always has a desire to be happy. Sarve sukhina bhavantu. Every living entity desires to be happy. Every living entity strives to be happy. We don't really need any scriptural knowledge to understand that every living entity wants to be happy. We see even in the lowest species of life. You can see the fish, you can see the animals, you can see the birds. What are they doing? What are the activities of a bird? Collecting food, building a nest, trying to make a small family. Somehow or the other, trying to protect itself and trying to be happy. Even the lowest species, bacteria, microbes, even they try to be happy by gathering some food, by trying to make themselves safe. But what is the problem here? The living entities do not know how to be happy. In the material situation, where there is death, there is birth, old age, death and disease, no one can really be happy. In the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, it is written, Asato ma satgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityor ma amritam gamaya. You cannot be happy in the situation that you are in. Living as you are, by getting more facilities, more wealth, more food, you cannot be happy. The scriptures are explaining you are in the wrong situation. You're not supposed to be happy here. You cannot be happy here. So it says, Asato ma satgamaya. What is the source of your unhappiness? What is it that makes anyone unhappy? Asat. It has two translations in English, the word Sanskrit, asat. One means temporary, and the second means untrue. This may be lasting for 3 years or 4 years. Therefore, it doesn't have a permanent existence. Asat. This asat is the source of all our unhappiness. Everything. Relationships break away. Our health goes away. The body itself grows old and dies. Asat. So therefore, the Upanishads say, Asato ma satagamaya. Don't be in this untrue temporary position. Satagamaya. Be in an eternal situation. But how do you go to this eternal situation? Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya. Don't be in ignorance. This only the living entity has to do. This you have to do. You have to come out of ignorance. No one can take you into light. You have to go. Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya. And when you do that, what happens? Mrityor ma amritam gamaya. Don't stay in death. Come to life. Mrityor ma amritam gamaya. So this situation, this temporary situation, this is the source of all our miseries and all our problems, all the difficulties of our life. And this is not described not just for us, for every living entity, from lowest to the highest, up to the position of Lord Brahma. Lord Brahma has a life, like practically eternal life, but even that ends at one point. That is the source of unhappiness for him also. Because after falling down from the position of Brahma, even Brahma has to take some other form. And he doesn't know which form. Depending on the desires and karma. So therefore, to guide us from that position of asata, the Lord appears millennium after millennium. And he comes here to give us the teachings to get out, how to get out of this process, how to get out of this material tabernacle. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna gives the instruction. He says, Sarva dharmana parityajya mama ekam sharanam braja. Aham tvama sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami ma shucha. Give up all varieties of religion and surrender unto me. Sarva dharma, the word dharma doesn't mean religion actually. It means duty, it means character, it means religion. It has all these meanings. Every living entity is trying to be happy and trying to do something to be happy. We go to a university, we go to a college to study, take some education, then we move on to a better position, high ranking job, get a higher salary so that we can enjoy. We perform some dharma. Dharma as a student, dharma as a professional, dharma as a husband, wife, mother, father, dharmas. And these dharmas are not exactly pleasant. No one really enjoys 4 years of university education and examinations. No one really enjoys all the difficulties that come in a profession where you have to work and earn money and hear abuses from other people and somehow or the other struggle. No one really enjoys these things. But why do we do them then? Because we have a hope that by doing these we'll be happy. We'll attain some happiness, some pleasure. So Krishna says, Sarva dharmana parityajya mam ekam sharanam braja. Please give up these, you know, your mental misconceptions. Please give up these so-called duties you have created for yourself. Just surrender unto me. It is mentioned in the Gita that the Lord is the whole cosmic manifestation himself. He is the supreme conscious. Maya dhyakshena prakriti suyate supracharacharam. Every living entity is moving under my direction. The whole material creation, whether moving or non-moving, is under my direction. So the living entity need not fear. The acharyas say that our jobs, our professions are not the source of our income. Our karma is. These are just the means. If the living entity understands this, then he'll be happy. So to explain this, the Lord incarnates millennium after millennium in different forms, in different positions. And depending on the consciousness, he sends his representatives to explain the same truth in different ways. That's why we have the Bible, we have the Quran, we have the Torah, we have all these religious scriptures explaining the same purpose. sarva dharmanu parityajya mama ekam sharanam braja. Just come to me. Moksha ishami ma shucha. I will deliver you. Don't be in anxiety. Don't worry. Krishna is promising that. But our problem is that we cannot accept it. We always argue. Even when Krishna appeared, everyone argued. Like when Krishna went to Duryodhan to meet him, Duryodhan argued, "Who are you? Why should I listen to you? You are a Yadu. I am a Kuru. I am belonging to a superior lineage. Why should I listen to you? You are just an ordinary prince." So what happened? Duryodhan was annihilated. His whole armies were annihilated. His family was annihilated. Because that's the law of nature. Arjuna, he accepted Krishna. He called Param Dham. He called Krishna Param Dham. Oh, you are the ultimate destination. You are the Supreme Lord. And what happened to Arjuna? He got the kingdom of the world. And in the end, Krishna promised Arjuna, you know, you are priyosi me, you are very dear to me, you will come to me eternally. So Arjuna listened, Duryodhan did not listen. Unfortunately, the position of Duryodhan is also our position. We also argue, why should I surrender? We don't want to surrender to the Lord. So therefore, and especially, it is described in the scriptures, this particular age in which we live, the age of Kali, is described as the age of quarrel and hypocrisy. People will pretend to be religious, but they will always be quarrelsome. Why? You know, why should I listen to you? Why this? Why that? Well, Bible, Bhagavad Gita, they are all there available on the streets, but everyone, you know, why should I listen? Well, because you are dying. We are all dying. The eyesight is failing, the hair is falling, the teeth are falling out. That's why you should accept. No, I still won't accept. This is our position, unfortunately, all of us. So therefore, in the age of Kali, knowing the especially fallen condition of the human beings, the Lord does not appear as Lord Himself. When He comes as Ram or Krishna, He asserts His full authority. He displays miraculous activities. But in the age of Kali, He doesn't do that. Kalau channa. He appears as hidden. He comes as hidden avatar. How do we know that He is the avatar? So in this age of Kali, He just appears and He comes to give the same message. No? The message is the same, Bhagavad Gita. Sarva dharmana parityajya mama ekam. But He doesn't say it so directly. The Lord understands our consciousness. You know, these rascals, if I tell them again, they will again, like they'll argue even more. So He puts it very indirectly. Harer naam, harer naam, harer naam eva kevalam kalau nastiyev, nastiyev, nastiyev gatir anyatha. Please chant the names of Hari. And when someone says, oh, you are Hari, Hari Krishna, Krishna, Vishnu, Vishnu, I am not Hari. He doesn't accept that. Kalau channa, because He comes as a hidden avatar, just as His own devotee. Why does He do that? So, how do we know that He is the avatar? So, according to scriptures, one does not accept the avatar just like that because, you know, 100 people are saying He's avatar, so I'll accept Him. No, there is a scientific process. The scriptures explain, Guru, Sadhu and Shastra must proclaim the absolute truth. So the spiritual master, Srila Rupa Goswami, he says, Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaurat Vishaye Namah. That, O most merciful Lord Krishna, you have appeared in this golden form as your own devotee and you are giving the holy names of, you are giving your own holy names. We are Rupanuga, we are Gaudiya Vaishnavas, we are Rupanugas, so He is our Guru. Then there is Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. He proclaims Lord Chaitanya as the Supreme Lord. There is the other five Goswamis. Then there are scriptures. Vishnu Sahasranama Stotram says, Suvarna Varno He Mango, that the Lord appears, Suvarna Varna in a golden form, He Mango with a golden body. Suvarna Varna He Mango. Then Srimad Bhagavatam explains, Srimad Bhagavatam, here we've seen in this verse, it explains, Krishna Varnam Tusha Krishnam Sango Pangastra Parshadam Yajna Sankirta Prayer Yajanti Hi Sumedasa. That the Supreme Lord in the age of Kali Krishna Varnam Tvisha Krishnam. That same chanting the names of Krishna, Krishna will appear in a form which is a Krishna, in a not a black form. And he will appear with his associates, with his friends, with his family, and his weapons. And his main weapon would be Sankirtana. Yajna Sankirtana prayer, Yajanti hi Sumedasa. And only those who are intelligent will follow him. Those who are intelligent will give up all other processes and only chant the holy names. So in this way, Lord Chaitanya will establish the same religious process that Krishna was trying to establish in the Dwapara Yuga. But he does it in a more diplomatic way. He comes as a devotee to explain the same process, because we are so stubborn that we will not accept it. So he says, but there is one difference. As our acharyas explain, that when Krishna appeared, he put this very strict condition, you know, because at least in Dwapara Yuga people were a little more learned and qualified. So he put this condition. He said, Sarva Dharmana Parityajya. Before that he also said, you know, always think of me. He said, you know, always think of me, become my devotee. But in the age of Kali, he puts it very simply. He says, Hare Ranam Eva Kevalam. You just chant the holy names. He doesn't discuss any philosophy. He doesn't give any instructions. He just gives the holy name. Just chant, chant and be happy. So, as Srila Prabhupada explains, how do we, you know, why does Krishna do this? And how do we accept his authority? If he has appeared as a devotee, why do we accept his authority? Is he Krishna really? What is his position? So Srila Prabhupada explains. He says, you know, you have come to massage me, but you don't know how to massage properly. So I will show you with my hand, you know, please, you know, massage like this. So that doesn't mean that I have become the massager. I have just come to show you how to massage properly. And once you learn, then you do it. You know, then you still maintain the same position. So in this way, Lord Chaitanya takes the role of a servant. He is begging, you know, please chant the holy names. But that doesn't mean that he has become our servant. He is still the Supreme Lord. He is our Lord. Mat prananathastu sadeva napara. He is under all circumstances, in all conditions. He is always our Lord. But he has taken that position to show us how to do it. So if we see the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya, so there's an excellent scripture called Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, which explains in details the activities and pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. The three parts of Chaitanya Charitamrita explain the three processes, like three stages of a devotee's life. In the first stage, Lord Chaitanya plays the activities of an ordinary learned man. He is a very pious Brahmana, but he does not display any devotional character. He is a proud, learned Brahmana. He is always challenging others. Of course, he is Krishna, so he is very attractive and people love him also. But he is not playing that role. So he is playing the role of an arrogant, learned Brahmana, always challenging others to scriptural arguments. At the end of this Leela, he accepts the lotus feet of his guru. He accepts a bona fide spiritual master, Srila Ishwarpuri. And after that, he immediately displays the symptoms of a surrendered soul. He's constantly chanting the holy names of the Lord, and he's only discussing topics related to Krishna. And he gives up all mundane activities. And he inaugurates the Sankirtan movement. But he is still a grihastha. Later on, he takes on the role of a sannyasi, and he dedicates his life exclusively to preaching the holy names and the message of the scriptures. In this way, he displays the role of a madhyam adhikari who has acquired knowledge, who has purified his existence, but he is now doing the charity work of preaching the holy names of the Lord. And in the last part of his Leela, he completely withdraws from public activities and he only displays the ecstasies of pure love of Krishna, where he is constantly reciting the names of Krishna and his associates, and he is displaying the ecstasy of love of Godhead. So through his own life, because Lord Chaitanya, he is not just the Lord, he is also Acharya, and in fact he is the Acharya of Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. So through his own life, he is showing what are the different stages of devotional life. So in this way, Lord Chaitanya, not just through his instructions, but also through his own activities, he is displaying what happens when you take to the chanting of the holy names of the Lord. So this is the glory of Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya did not leave behind too many instructions. While he glorified Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, he himself did not give any scripture. Lord Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita, but Lord Chaitanya did not give any scripture. But he just left behind 8 instructions known as the Shiksha Ashtakam. In these 8 instructions, he has also displayed the various stages of devotional life, beginning with what happens when you start chanting the holy names, what is the glory of holy name, what should be the mood and attitude for accepting the holy name, what should be your lifestyle, you know, what should be your mind, mental attitude when you start worshipping the Lord, and what happens when you become purified, what is the spiritual ecstasy that you attain. So in this way, this Shiksha Ashtaka, these 8 verses, we don't have much time today actually, so we'll just stop it here. Perhaps some other day we'll discuss these 8 verses of Shiksha Ashtakam. They are extremely important. So one of these 8 verses, the third verse is considered very important. Srila Prabhupada used to quote it quite often. How should one chant the holy name? Trinad api sunichena taror eva sahishnuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadahari. This is the mood that Lord Chaitanya was always in. Trinad api sunichena, humble as a blade of grass. Taror eva sahishnuna, as tolerant as a tree. Amanina manadena, giving all respect to those, even those who are not respecting us. Kirtaniya sadahari, in this mood we can always chant the holy names of the Lord. A more technical explanation of this is that we just understand that we are just passengers in this material world. We are just travelers. This is not our permanent place. Whatever is happening here is just happening because of our past karmas. We just tolerate all the sufferings and we give respect to everyone else, considering them to be part and parcels of Krishna. And in this way, we always think only of Krishna. In this way, our mind is purified and we are always able to think of Krishna. So this was the mood that Lord Chaitanya was always in. And in this mood, he was preaching the holy names of the Lord. Please understand, even when the Lord appears, it's not that there are people who are not blaspheming him also. Nobody, except for a handful of people, nobody accepted Krishna also. So likewise, even when Lord Chaitanya was preaching, not everybody accepted his message. But Lord Chaitanya displayed this mood because he was in the mood of a preacher. So this is our movement, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, is Lord Chaitanya's manifestation. Srila Prabhupada called it a branch of Chaitanya tree. So this is the mood and attitude that all of us as Gaudiya Vaishnavas should also cultivate. And ours is a preaching movement. There are various Vaishnava Sampradayas. There are millions of devotees of Lord Krishna, Lord Vishnu in the world. Some of these Sampradayas are only in the worship of deity. Some of them are only in the silent meditation. But we as Gaudiya Vaishnavas, our mood is always that of preaching. Because that's the mood Lord Chaitanya has set for us. Preaching of the holy names of the Lord. Sankirtana movement. We are a Sankirtan movement. It means we sing the holy names of the Lord and we give the message of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam Pramanam Amalam Prema Pumartho Mahan Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhor Matamidam Tatradara Napara. So Srimad Bhagavatam is the essence of all scriptures. And love of God is the ultimate objective of all living entities. When living entities attain love of God, they'll be eternally happy. This is the message of Srimad Bhagavatam, and Lord Chaitanya specifically instructs this. Therefore, we accept it as an order from the spiritual master. So therefore, on this auspicious occasion of Lord Chaitanya's appearance, just as the moon rises, Lord Chaitanya also manifests in our lives. So on this auspicious time when Lord Chaitanya is about to appear, my humble request to all of you is, please read the Srimad Bhagavatam carefully. Srila Prabhupada said, read these books scrutinizingly. So study Srimad Bhagavatam scrutinizingly. Study the Shiksha Ashtakam. You can find them in the books, you can find them on the internet also. And meditate on each verse carefully and see how it applies in our lives. As Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami says, even if you are an expert logician, please apply your logic to the mercy of Lord Chaitanya and you will find a miracle in your own life. So please meditate very carefully on the instructions of Lord Chaitanya and what his appearance means, and you will see a miracle in your own life. Thank you very much. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki, Srila Prabhupada ki. Any questions or comments, please? Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. First, there must be a Guru, a bona fide spiritual master. What he says must be also said, must have been spoken by the Sadhus also, other sages. And that must also be confirmed by the scriptures, holy scriptures. So for example, when we accept Jesus Christ as a representative of the Lord, there must be other saintly souls also who should confirm this. So when we accept Krishna, so we don't accept Krishna because someone, like in India, some people say Krishna is God. No, we accept the authorities of the sages, we accept a bona fide spiritual master, and we talk about the scriptures. So we have to, like a certain degree of faith we must have, but this faith must be corroborated from other sources also. Yeah, so because he shows us the way forward. It's a whole body of teaching. Yeah. You're welcome. Yes.
One question. since there is hundreds of millions of planets where there are people who are much more advanced than people here on Earth, I sometimes wonder that it's one of the biggest wonders for me, at least, that why should Krishna, the Godhead of all the universe, take actually any notice of this particular planet? What is so special about this place?
He's everywhere. It's not just us. He's even taking care of the worms that are crawling in the mud outside. In fact, whether one is a devotee or an atheist, you know, avowed atheist, I don't believe, I don't even want to believe in God, still Krishna is taking care of him. If Krishna wishes, he can annihilate the soul. Finished, you know, kaput, nothing. But he is taking care of everything. Whether you believe in him or not, you have faith in him, you love him, you don't love him, he is still taking. Everyone in all circumstances at all times is completely dependent on Krishna. Not just on this planet, in all the innumerable millions of planets, and not just the planets, innumerable universes. All this manifest. We are in fact sitting on the body of the Supreme Lord. There is like really no question of us being separated from Lord at any time. There is really no separation. It's just our consciousness. That's why it is called Maya. That which is not, it's forgetfulness, it's an illusion. At all circumstances, we are just dependent on the Lord. Nobody likes this dull weather, but we can't change anything. Nature has manifested, so we have to accept it. This is the power of Krishna. Maya jhakshena prakriti suyate su characharam.
Sorry, but he appeared here in Vrindavan. He was born, he had parents here, he was born here, so then has to be something very special, because this kind of lila don't happen in every place in the universe, does it?
No, not in all places.
So why the Earth?
Well, we're just lucky.
Actually, I can answer to that. Long time ago, Maharishi Prabhu cursed Vishnu to incarnate to planet Earth unlimited time to end of all ages.
Well, that's just one of the external manifestations. Lord cannot be cursed by anyone. He can.
Well, he received the curse because.
Yeah, if he wants, he
saw the needs that people in this planet need him to incarnate.
So, for example, to give you one more example, in the heavenly planets where Indra, the king of heavens, is residing, the Lord is also living there in the form of Upendra. He's the brother of Indra there. So he comes, Upendra, he's like mini Indra. He's the brother of Indra. He appears there. So in all the planets, he's there. In this world, in this particular part, he appears as Krishna. That is just his wish. He's Abhigya Swarat. He's fully knowledgeable, but he's completely independent. He does his own activities. So he just appears. But the Leelas are available everywhere. In the heavenly planets, people are far more learned. They can see the Lord directly. He's just like traveling there frequently. But here, he has appeared and gone. Now we have to meditate on him and try to attain him. So he's there everywhere. Everywhere in different forms. Yes.
How do we know that it doesn't happen simultaneously everywhere and on the other planets?
It is happening. No, it is happening simultaneously in all planets.
Yeah, okay.
It's there. Lord is what to speak of other planets. When Krishna was here, he was expanding into thousands of forms.
No.
This particular Leela doesn't happen everywhere else.
Sorry.
Yeah, he's everywhere. Different Leelas are manifesting.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Can you explain about the process of blessings and mercy?
Oh, blessings of a guru. Well, if you remember the first verse of Sri Chaitanya Shikshashtak, Cheto Darpana Marjanam Bhava Mahadavagni Nirvapanam Shreya Kerava Chandrika Avataranam Vidya Vadhu Jeevanam Anandam Budhi Vardhanam Pratipadam Purnamrit Asvadanam Sarvatma Snapanam Param Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankirtanam. Benediction. What is a benediction actually? We have to understand. A benediction is where a person of some capability gives you something that you don't have. Like from a very technical perspective. For example, I go to a rich man and I say, sir, I am very poor. Can you please give me something? He says, okay, here, take 100 euros. That's a benediction. Because he has it, I don't. He has given me. When he gives me something, he also, kind of loses something. So in case of spiritual process, the benediction, see, we are in a terrible condition. We are in birth, old age, death and disease and so many other miseries. We are in a terrible condition. What is the benediction that we can ask for? Please, so as Rupa Goswami asks, who am I and why am I suffering? Two very important questions Rupa Goswami asked Lord Chaitanya up front. He's not asking Lord Chaitanya, what is this universe? Who am? What is the position of different entities? No, he's asking a very simple question. Who am I? And why am I suffering like this? So that is the question that an intelligent man should ask. Why am I suffering? So this is the question. So Rupa Goswami is a disciple and Lord Chaitanya is the guru here. This is the question he's asking, establishing the parampara. So the benediction that a guru gives is to deliver us from this hellish condition. Why? Because guru himself is delivered from this position. The guru is not suffering birth, old age, death and disease like us. That's why the scriptures tell us. The guru must be a first-class devotee of the Lord, Paramahansa. That means he's always relishing the leelas of the Lord. He's living in the leelas of the Lord. He's a delivered soul. Therefore, he can deliver us. If I am drowning in the sea and you are also drowning, I will not be able to save you. But if I am in a boat, then I can pull you up. So guru is in that position. He's in that position. He has taken up that safety position. He's at the shelter. So he's known as Guru. So like Srila Prabhupada, what does Prabhupada mean? One who has taken the shelter of the Lord, Prabhupada. One who is at the shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord. So So Guru can give this benediction. So this is the benediction that a Guru gives. So Srila Prabhupada explains that sometimes people ask for benedictions, you know, Maharaj, please bless me, I'll have a beautiful wife. Please bless me, I'll have some money, you know, some wealth or some good health. This is not a benediction, really. This is like, you know, you're asking for death. If you, so like, for example, sometimes in India, people have this habit of asking for, you know, praying for, like, they go to Lord Shiva to worship for a beautiful wife. But what is that? Just attachment to the material world. For example, Chanakya Pandit says, Rupavati Bharya Shatru, beautiful wife is an enemy. Why? Because husband, wife, a handsome husband, beautiful wife, attraction means only being attached to this material world. Death will come, whether one is beautiful or not beautiful. So this is not a benediction. So for example, Lord Chaitanya says in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Ami vignya ei murkha vishaya kene deva. I am knowledgeable, I am intelligent, I am Ami vignya, I have knowledge. Ei murkha, he is a fool. Why is he asking me for material benediction? Why should I give him a material benediction? So in fact, Srila Prabhupada explains, if you are worshipping Lord Chaitanya for material benefits, he will take away whatever you have also. That's his benediction. So that you become completely dependent on the Lord, and then you will be delivered from this birth, old age, death and disease. So benediction means being delivered from miserable condition. So when we ask a rich man for wealth, we are asking for relief from misery. So when we ask benediction from a guru, we are asking for deliverance from miserable condition. We are murkha, we are fools. We don't know what is the source of our misery. Sometimes I think, oh, I don't have a job, therefore I am miserable. Well, that is just a temporary misery. The real misery is that I am here, that I am in this body. That is the real misery, that is the real problem. A cancer patient has pain, but taking a painkiller will not help. That will just keep the pain out, but the disease will still be there. Our disease is this materialism. So like Gajendra is praying to the Lord, you know, my Lord, I do not wish to be delivered. I do not wish to be delivered from this body. You please give me deliverance from this materialistic condition. You save me from this crocodile and from this material nature, which is like crocodile. So deliver me from ignorance, which is not destroyed by the time factor. So that is the real benediction. That is how one asks for a benediction. That is a benediction. Everything else is ignorance. Everything else is a curse.
Why is it a curse? It's a very strong word.
Yes, because it binds you to material world. It increases your desire. If you see, why do you want? So it is. Yeah, but there are guns, so people are killing with guns. If you don't have a gun, nobody shoots. So material nature, wealth is not bad. Having a family life is not bad. If you are using them in the service of Krishna, Rupa and Sanatan Goswami were beautiful, very handsome people, and they were very knowledgeable and extremely wealthy. They used it all in the service of Krishna. That is a benediction. Using everything in the service of Krishna. That means service of Krishna is benediction, but sense gratification is the curse. Does that answer your question, Prabhu?
Thank you very much.
I think we are now. Yeah, time is up. Any? Okay, yeah. We can talk later. Sure. Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jaya.